Today's video will be discussing about Physics Paper 1, MCQ Paper 2024, May-June, variant is 11 and the subject code is 9702. Number 1. Which unit is an SI base unit? So for SI base unit, we know that there are 7 base SI quantities. So, or 7 base quantities: length, mass, time, current, temperature, luminous intensity and amount of substance. So, luminous intensity and amount of substance is not in our syllabus, or not in physics, but the SI unit of length is meter, the SI unit of mass is kg, the SI unit of time is second, the SI unit of current is ampere, and the SI unit of temperature is Kelvin. So, what is the SI base unit? So, coulomb is not the unit, according to the options. Degree centigrade is not the unit, it would be Kelvin. Then, gram is not the unit, it would be kg. But, ampere is the unit of current. So yes, this is SI base unit. Question number 2. Which of the following could have the same unit at force? So which has the same unit as force? So we know that force is equal to mass into acceleration. Also force is equal to change in momentum by change in time. So you need to remember these two equations. And from mass into acceleration, the unit of mass is kg and the unit of acceleration is meter per second square. So, according to the options, the correct answer would be A, because energy is equal to, let us consider the kinetic energy, that is half mv square, and the distance. So, the unit of mass is kg, the unit of v square is meter square per second square, and the unit of distance is meter. So, this square cancels with this meter, and it would be kg meter per second square. So, this is equal to the unit of force. So yes, the answer is correct. Number 3. The velocity of an object changes from an initial velocity u to a final velocity v. The vectors represent these velocities, so u and v. Which single vector represents the change in velocity of the object? So change in velocity is equal to, so for any change, we know that the change in velocity is equal to final velocity minus the initial velocity. That is, for any change, it is equal to final minus initial. So this is the final velocity minus the initial velocity. So we need to minus the initial velocity, that is we need to get negative u. So u is in this direction, but if you want to take negative u, then the negative u must have this direction, that is the direction is reversed. So if we just join the negative u by head to tail, then the head of this arrow to the tail of this arrow, so this is negative u, and what is the resultant? Or the single vector that is representing single vector, or the resultant vector. So the resultant vector is the addition of the two vector, or the change in vector, that is this change in vector. So this is the change in velocity. This is a single vector that represents a change in velocity, that is del v. And del v is equal to v minus vi. That is final velocity minus initial velocity. That is v minus u. So this is in this direction, that is answer C. Correct to the given. In question number 4, an object is moving with initial velocity u. The object then moves with uniform acceleration a for the time t until it reaches the final velocity v. Which equation describes the motion of the object? So you need to remember three equations. There is v is equal to u plus at, v square minus u square is equal to 2s, s is equal to ut plus half at square. And this last equation, s is equal to vt minus half at square. This is not really used in regular basis, but this is necessary for both mechanics and physics. So this is necessary when none of them are used. So this is an important equation, but this is not regularly used. So basically, you need to solve by using these three. And if these three equations become useless, then you need to use this for mechanics or for physics, and also for physics. So which equation describes the motion of the object? So by using these three equations, we can see that this is not similar to any of this equation. Then v is equal to u plus at, then v square minus u square. So this is not the same of any of this equation. Also, this is not the same. But here, we can see that v is equal to u plus at if we rearrange this equation. So the correct answer is B.
5. Which calculation produces a vector quantity? So current into time. Charge is equal to current into time. A charge is a scalar quantity, then final displacement minus initial displacement is a change in displacement, and the change in displacement, so it is displacement, So it has both magnitude and direction. So yes, it is a vector quantity. Then what then but per unit time or energy per unit time is power. So power has no direction. So therefore it is only a scalar quantity. And half mv square is kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is also a scalar quantity since it has magnitude only and no direction. So the correct answer is B. Then for question number 6, a thermometer can be read to an accuracy of 0.5 degrees Celsius. Thermometer is used to measure a temperature rise from 40 degrees centigrade to 100 degrees centigrade. What is the percentage uncertainty in the measurement of the temperature rise? So what is the percentage uncertainty in the measurement of the temperature rise? The percentage uncertainty is the approximate change in value, by the total value into 100%. So what is the approximate change in value? So first of all, what is the total value? So temperature rise, percentage uncertainty in the temperature rise. That means our total value is the temperature rise. So what is the temperature rise? Final temperature minus initial temperature is the temperature rise. So final minus initial is the temperature rise, 100%. And so this is the uncertainty that we have given. So this much uncertainty when measuring the initial temperature, that is 40 degrees centigrade. This uncertainty is also when measuring the final temperature, that is 100 degrees centigrade. So when measuring 40 degrees centigrade, there is an uncertainty of 0.5. Also when measuring 100 degrees centigrade, there is an uncertainty of 0.5. So 0.5 plus 0.5 or 0.5 into 2 by the temperature rise into 100%. So the percentage uncertainty we get is 1.7%.
Question number 7. The diagram shows the path of a golf ball, which describes the changes in the horizontal and the vertical component of the golf ball's velocity. So the horizontal component and the vertical component of golf ball's velocity when air resistance is ignored. So this is the usual velocity, and if we just break down into its horizontal and vertical component, then this is the horizontal component of velocity and this is the vertical component of velocity of the ball at this point. So for the horizontal component of velocity, we can say that for a ball in the horizontal direction, there is no horizontal force acting on the ball. That means there is no force is acting in the horizontal direction. Since there is no force is acting in the horizontal direction, and we know that force is equal to mass into acceleration, and in the horizontal direction, the force is zero, so acceleration is also zero. And since acceleration is zero, so the ball is moving at a constant velocity. So the velocity is constant, and for the vertical component of velocity, we can see that for the ball's vertical component of velocity, there is a force acting on the ball in the vertical direction, that is the weight. So the weight of the ball is acting vertically downward. And we know that weight is equal to mass into gravitational field strength, and weight is acting vertically downward. And we know that weight is a force, and we know that force is equal to mass into acceleration. So weight is constant, so force is constant, and since force is constant, mass is same, so acceleration is constant. So constant acceleration, and since weight is acting downward, so the acceleration is also acting downward. So the correct answer is C. Question number 8. An aircraft flies from London to Sydney in a time of 21 hours and 40 minutes. The distance traveled is 6 km. What is the average speed of the aircraft? So average speed is denoted by this sign. And we know that average speed is equal to total distance traveled by total time taken. So we need to convert this distance to meter. That is kilometer to meter, that is 10 to the power 3 meter. And 21 hours to second, that is 21 hours into 60 minutes into 60 seconds. And 40 minutes to 40 into 60, that is 40 into 60 seconds. So after calculating, we get the average speed. And all of the answers are given to 2.2. So we convert this to 2.2 into the power 2 meter per second. And from all of these options, the option C is correct. That is, if we convert this to meter per second, then it would be 2.2 into the power 2. That is correct. So the answer is C. Number 9. So here we have given the diagram of 4 seconds time. Which graph shows the velocity of the ball varies with time? So here we can see that from the graph, the force is constant and increasing. The force increases and the increasing force is constant. So force is constant and increasing, and we know that force is equal to mass into acceleration. So mass is same, so acceleration is also constant and increasing. So from the velocity time graph, we know that the gradient of the velocity time graph is acceleration. So the gradient of the velocity time graph is the acceleration. So here we can say that the gradient is same or the gradient is constant. So the velocity is same. Since the gradient is constant, so velocity is same. Since the velocity is same, so acceleration is zero. But here we can see that acceleration is constant increasing. Therefore, option D, here we can see that the velocity is constant and increasing and the gradient of the velocity time graph is acceleration. So here we can see that acceleration is constant. Acceleration is constant. But here we can see that acceleration is constant and increasing. But here acceleration is constant. Therefore, it is wrong. Then, for option A and B, here we can see that the acceleration is constant and increasing. So acceleration must increase. So here we can see that acceleration increases. But up to this point, acceleration increases. And for option A, here we can see that up to this point, that is this point, the acceleration value decreases. The gradient, we can see that the gradient decreases. The gradient here decreases, so acceleration decreases. But here we need an increasing gradient, not a decreasing gradient. Therefore, the option A is wrong, and the correct answer is B. Question number 10. What is meant by the mass and by the weight of an object on the earth? So, mass is equal to, so first of all, its momentum divided by its velocity. So, momentum is equal to mass into velocity. Therefore, mass is equal to momentum by its velocity. This statement is correct. The gravitational force, this is wrong. The pull of the earth on it, this is wrong. Then, the property that resists its acceleration. Yes, this statement is correct. Because mass is a property of a body that resists to its motion or its acceleration. Then weight, the work done in lifting it in 1 meter, this is wrong. Then the property that resists to its acceleration, this is wrong. Then weight is, it's the mass divided by acceleration of the free fall. So we know that weight is equal to mass into acceleration of free fall, that is the gravitational force. Therefore, this is wrong. This is not divided, this is multiplied. Then, the pull of the earth on it. So, this is correct. That is, the weight is the pull, weight of an object is the pull of the earth on it. So, the correct statement is D. 11. The thin horizontal plate of area given is beneath the surface of a liquid of density given. The force on one side of the plate due to the pressure of the liquid is 290 Newton. What is the depth of the plate beneath the surface of the liquid? So, what is the depth of the plate beneath the surface of the liquid? What is the depth of the plate beneath the surface of the liquid? That is, we need to find the height of the liquid above the surface of the plate. So, we know that pressure is equal to force by area. Also, we know that pressure is equal to rho gh. So, we need to find the height, that is, the depth of the liquid above the surface of the plate. And we know the value of gravitational force, that is 9.81. And we need and we know the density of the liquid, but we need to find the value of pressure. So, pressure is equal to force by area. So, we know the value of force and the area. By substituting the value, we find the value of pressure. Then we substitute the value of pressure in this formula. And we know the value of density that is given. And the gravitational force is 9.81. After substituting the values, we get the value of height, that is 0.88 meter. So, the correct statement would be A. Number 12. Sphere X and Y form an isolated system. The mass of Y is greater than the mass of X. So, mass of Y is greater than the mass of X. Sphere Y is initially stationary, that is, velocity of Y is zero. Sphere X collides elastically with sphere Y. So, since elastic collision occurs, so for elastic collision, we know that kinetic energy is conserved and the relative speed of approach is equal to relative speed of separation, that is u1 plus v1 is equal to u2 plus v2. The speed of sphere X before the collision is u. So before the collision it is u, which statement must be correct? So by using relative speed of approach is equal to relative speed of separation, we know that u1 plus v1 is equal to u2 plus v2. And here, the value of E1 is U, the value of V1, so here the value of V1 is not given, that is the velocity of X, so we consider this as Vx, then the value of U2, so U2 is 0, since the velocity of Y is 0, and V2 is the velocity of Y after collision, that is Vy, so if we just rearrange this expression, then Vy minus Vx is equal to u. Now, the sphere x rebounds with a speed greater than u, and sphere y moves off with a speed less than u. So x rebounds, so it moves backward, so the velocity would be negative, that is Vx is negative, and y moves off with a speed less than u. So if we just write these values, so Vy, and since x rebounds, so the velocity of x would be negative Vx is equal to u. So Vy plus Vx is equal to u. And here we have given that the velocity x rebounds with a speed greater than u. So since it has a speed greater than u, so greater than u, and y moves off with a speed less than u, so less than u. So if both the values are added, that is the value greater than u and the value less than u, so it would obviously give a value that is greater than this u. Therefore, this option would be wrong, since left hand side would not be equal to right hand side. Then for option D, so option 1 is wrong. Then for option D, sphere x remains stationary and y moves off with a speed less than u. So x remains stationary, so x is stationary and y moves off with a speed less than u. So Vy is less than u. So here Vy is less than u. So as we can see that left hand side is not equal to right hand side, therefore this option is wrong. So the answer is D is also wrong. Then for option C, sphere x rebounds with speed u and sphere y remains stationary. So y remains stationary, so the velocity of y is 0, and x rebounds with speed u. So since it rebounds, so the velocity of x would be negative, that is negative is equal to u. So here we can see that the left hand side is equal to right hand side, that is x rebounds with a speed of u. So since it rebounds with a speed of u, that is speed has a u, and since it rebounds, so the velocity would be negative. So here, and y is stationary, so y is stationary. So here we can see that left hand side is equal to right hand side, that is u is equal to u. But for the conservation of momentum, that is the initial momentum mu plus y is stationary, so 0. And after the collision, here we can see that for this option, y is stationary, so the momentum is 0, since mass and velocity is 0, and x has a momentum, that is x has a mass of m, and since it rebounds, so the velocity would be negative u. So here we can see that after solving this equation, mu is equal to negative mu. So here we can see that mu is equal to negative mu. Therefore, this option is wrong, because left hand side have to be right hand. Left hand side is equal to right hand side. And if here just we cancel the masses, then here we can see that u is equal to negative u. Therefore, this option is wrong, because left hand side have to be equal to the right hand side. Therefore, the option C is also wrong. Though it is equal to u, but momentum is not conserved. Therefore, the option C is wrong. And for option B, x rebounds with a speed less than u. So x rebounds, so the velocity would be negative and Vx would be negative. So x rebounds with a speed less than u. So since it rebounds, so Vx would be negative and y moves off with a speed that is less than u. So Vy is equal to u. And if we just write this equation, then Vy plus Vx is equal to u. And for the values, here we have given that the velocity of x is less than u, and the Vy is also less than u. So if the two values are added that are the less than u, then it can be equal to u. So the option C is correct until now. And if we just find the change in momentum, or by using the momentum equation, mass of x into velocity of x is u, and y is stationary, so y is stationary. And for after the collision, x rebounds with a speed less than u, that is m, so mx, and so mass of x we consider as mx, and it rebounds with a speed less than u, so vx is less than u, plus my, that is the mass of y, and vy. Here we have given that the velocity of y is also less than u, so less than u. So here we can see that mxu, that is the initial mass and velocity of x, that is before collision, is equal to mx and the velocity that is less than u, plus my and the velocity that is less than u. So it can be equal that left hand side is equal to right hand side. Therefore, the option can be B, because here we don't know the true values. Therefore, we cannot say that this is wrong. It can be equal. Therefore, the more appropriate answer is B, but for the other options, we can clearly state that the options are wrong, but for this answer, by knowing these values, we can consider the answer, but it is the most probable answer that can be correct. So the answer B is correct. And the other options are surely wrong. So by eliminating, we can see that the answer B is correct among all the options.
Question number 13. The ball of mass 0.1 kg is thrown towards a stationary vertical bat. So the ball is thrown. The ball hits the bat with a horizontal velocity of 20 meters per second. The ball rebounds. So the ball rebounds, that means moves backwards and leaves the bat with a horizontal velocity of 15 meters per second. So we have given the value of horizontal velocity after it rebounds, and since it rebounds, so it moves backwards, therefore the velocity would be negative. Because if we consider the velocity towards the right as positive, then the velocity towards the left as negative. So since it is moving towards the left, so the velocity is negative. What is the change in momentum of the ball? So we know that change in momentum is equal to final momentum minus initial momentum, and we have given the mass of the ball. So mass into final velocity of the ball minus the mass into initial velocity of the ball. So the change in momentum comes to be this value, that is negative 3.5 Newton second. And if we just consider the magnitude, so the answer would be D. Number 14, an accelerated object of negligible weight is acted on by two coplanar forces of the same magnitude. So the object is acted by two coplanar forces. In which diagram is the object in equilibrium? So for option D, we can see that the two forces are acting on the block, and for these two forces, the object is obviously moving, therefore it is not at equilibrium. And for equilibrium, we must know that the resultant force on an object is zero and the resultant moment on the object is zero. So for an equilibrium, the resultant force on an object is zero and the resultant moment on an object is zero. Then here we can see that the two forces are acting on the object and the object is moving upward, therefore it is not at equilibrium. Then for option B, here we can see that two forces are acting like a couple, and we know that couple is the product of force and the perpendicular distance between the two forces. So that is the torque or the moment of a couple. So the torque or the moment of a couple is the force and the perpendicular distance between the two forces. So the perpendicular distance between the two forces, and here we can see that the moment is acting on the blocks and also forces are acting. Therefore, the option B is wrong. And for option A, we can see that this upward force is cancelled by this downward force. So the object is at equilibrium. Therefore, the resultant force is zero, since the upward force cancels with the downward force and the resultant moment is also zero. So the answer is A. Question number 15. A firm beam PQ rests horizontally on a support at point S. A rope is attached at one end of the beam. The rope is at an angle of 60 degrees to the vertical and exerts a force F in newtons on the beam. So this is the rope, it exerts a force F, and this is at an angle of 60 degrees. What is the moment in Newton meter of the force about the point S? So what is the moment about point S? So we know that the moment of force is the product of force and the perpendicular distance from this pivot to the line of action of force. That is, the distance have to be perpendicular distance and the force have to be perpendicular force. So if we just break the force F into its components, then it would be F cos 60 and F sin 60. So the product of perpendicular force and the distance from the pivot. So this is the perpendicular force, that is F cos 60. And the perpendicular distance from the pivot is 2.5 meter minus 0.30 meter. So 2.5 minus 0.30, that is the distance from the pivot to the line of action of force, and the force have to be a perpendicular force. So after multiplying, we get a value that is 1.1 F. So the answer is A. Question number 16. The diagram shows the dimensions of an elastic cord used to project a stone. The tension in the cord is T when the cord is pulled into the shape shown. Which force does the elastic cord exert on the stone? So this is the stone, that is the stone we have given, and these are the two forces and the angle between the two forces. So if we just break the force T into its component, then this side would be T cos theta and this side would be T sin theta. Similarly, If you just break this force, then it will be t cos theta and t sin theta. Now, for this force, we need to find the angle theta. So, this side is 6 centimeter, and this total length is 16 centimeter. Since the total length is 16 centimeter, so the total length is 16 centimeter. Okay. But instead of considering this 16 centimeter, if you just consider that this 10 centimeter, then cos theta is equal to adjacent by hypotenuse. So we get the value of theta. That is the value of this theta and this theta. Then here we can see that t cos theta plus t cos theta is equal to the resultant force. Since the upward t sin theta cancels with the downward t sin theta, therefore the only resultant force is these two forces. So after calculating, we get the value that is 6/5t, that is answer B. Number 17, what is the total work done on the box by the two forces? So we need to find the total work. So the total work. So first of all, a box of weight given, that is the value of weight, is pulled with a horizontal force of 20 Newton. So we have given the value of horizontal force along a level ground for a distance of 2.4 meter. So we have given the horizontal force and the horizontal distance is 2.4 meter. So we know that work done is equal to force into distance. That is the horizontal force and the horizontal distance, since work done is equal to force and the distance moved by the object in the direction of the force. So the value of force is 20 Newton, that is in the horizontal direction. So the distance covered must be in the horizontal direction, that is 2.4 meter. So after multiplying, we get the value of work. That is the first work. Now for the second work, the box is then lifted at a constant velocity through a height of 1.6 meter by a vertical force. So this is the box and we have given its weight, that is 40 Newton. And it is pulled through and it is moved through a horizontal distance, vertical distance of 1.6 meter. So we have given the value of distance. Now what is the value of work? We know that work done is equal to force and the distance moved by the object in the direction of the force. Since we have given the vertical distance, so we need to find the vertical upward force. So what is the vertical upward force? Since the object is moving at a constant velocity, for an object at constant velocity, we know that resultant force is equal to mass into acceleration. But when the object is moving at a constant velocity, the acceleration is zero. Since the object is moving at a constant velocity, the acceleration is zero. That means the resultant force is zero. Since the resultant force is zero, so upward force is equal to downward force. And we have given the value of downward force, that is 40 Newton. So the upward force is also 40 Newton. That is 40 Newton and the distance is 1.6 meter. After multiplying, we get the work, that is 64 joules. So what is the total work? 48 joules plus 64 joules, that is 48 plus 64 is 112 joules, or approximately 110 joules. In first statement about efficiency is correct. So efficiency is the useful energy output by total energy input into 100%. So efficiency does not have a unit. So this statement is correct. Since efficiency is equal to useful energy output or useful power output divided by total power input, so the upward unit cancels with the downward unit and there is ultimately no unit. So the answer is correct. Question number 19. A plane wave of amplitude m is incident on the surface area. Incident on a surface area is placed so that it is perpendicular to the direction of travel of the wave. The energy per unit time reaching the surface is E. So here we have given this information. Then the amplitude of the wave is increased to 2m. From A, the amplitude is increased to 2m and the area of the surface is reduced to s by 2. Initially it is s, now it is s by 2. How much energy per unit time reaches a smaller surface? So energy per unit time, we know that energy per unit time is equal to power. So energy per unit time is power, and for the first expression, energy per unit time reaching the surface is E. That means we have given that power is equal to E. So for the first wave, we have given that power is equal to E, and we have given the value of power, and also we have given the amplitude and the surface area. So how can we connect power with amplitude and surface area? So power, amplitude and surface area. So we know that intensity is equal to power per unit area. So intensity is equal to power per unit area, and we have given the value of power, that is E. So E, and the area is S. So intensity by area is S. So for the first wave, we know the value of intensity,
And how can we connect intensity by amplitude? We know that intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. That means I1 by I2 is equal to A1 square by A2 square. So that's how we can relate intensity with area. Now this is for the first wave. And for the second wave, that is regarding the second condition, by using the second conditions, we have given the value of amplitude and the surface area. And how much energy per unit time, that means energy per unit time is power, so we consider this as x. So how much power for this smaller area? So we know that power is equal to energy per unit time. So power is equal to energy per unit time. So basically where we consider the value of power as x, since we don't have given this value, so power as x, that is energy per unit time as x. So we know the value of power, that is x, and intensity is equal to power that we have considered as x per unit area, and the surface area we have given is s by 2. So s 1 by 2. So the intensity comes to be 2x by s. So this is the intensity. Now we need to connect intensity with amplitude, that is given as 2a. So we know that intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. So now for the first condition, we know the value of intensity and the amplitude is given as a. And for the second condition, we know the value of intensity where we have considered power as x, and we know the intensity amplitude is 2a. So now for the first wave, for the first condition, we know the intensity, that is energy per unit area. So energy per unit area for the first condition, and for the second condition, we found the intensity as given. So 2x by s is equal to, what is the amplitude of the first wave? So the amplitude is a, and for the second wave, the amplitude is 2a. So a square by 2a square. Now, after solving this, or while solving this, after solving this, we get the value of x as 2e. And we know that initially we have considered x as power, so new power is 2e. So how much energy per unit time? That means the new power. So the new power is 2e. So the answer is B. Question number 20. A steel ball is falling at a constant speed in oil. So the ball is falling at a constant speed V in oil. Which graph shows the variation with time for the gravitational potential energy and kinetic energy of the ball? So we know that kinetic energy is equal to half mv square, and gravitational potential energy is equal to mass into gravitational resistance into height. Now for kinetic energy, we know that the ball is moving at a constant speed. Since it is moving at a constant speed, so speed is constant, so kinetic energy is same, or it is a horizontal line. So kinetic energy is same. That is, it is a horizontal line. Kinetic energy is same. Here it is not same. Here it is not same. Therefore it is wrong. Since it is moving at a constant speed, so there is no change in kinetic energy, and kinetic energy is same. Now what is the variation of gravitational potential energy? So since speed is constant, so the decreasing height is also constant, or the gravitational potential energy is uniform. So mass into gravitational resistance is obviously constant. So gravitational potential energy is directly proportional to height, and here the speed is constant. Since the speed is constant, so the decreasing height is same. So the decreasing height is same. That means the decrease in gravitational potential energy is also the same, or it is linear. So the answer would be B.
Question number 21. When a force of 0.80 Newton is applied to a spring, the length of the spring is 90 mm or 0.09 meter. When a force of 1.30 Newton is applied to the same spring, its length is 115 mm or 0.115 mm. The spring obeys Hooke's law means force is directly proportional to extension, and since force is directly proportional to extension, we can write it as force is equal to constant into extension. What is the spring constant of the spring? So we need to find the spring constant, that is the value of constant k. So F is equal to kx. So for the first spring, we know the value of force, and this is not the extension. This is the total length. The length of the spring is this much. So this is the total length that is increased. So the total length that is increased. So what is the extension? Extension is the increasing length, or the total length minus the initial length. Extension is equal to total length minus initial length. So this is our first expression, and for the second expression again, we know the Balois force, that is 1.3, is equal to K, and the extension is the total length minus the initial length, that is LO. So LO, and since it is the same spring, so the spring constant would be same. So for the two expressions, we find the two different values of spring constant, that is the two different equations. Then we equate the values of K, or the expressions of K, and we find the initial length, that is LO, as 0.05 meter. So we know the value of LO, that is the initial length, and we need to find the spring constant K. Now we can substitute this value in any of this equation to find the value of K. So we have substituted this in equation 1, or this in this equation, and find the value of K as 20 Newton per meter. So the answer is D, that is 20 Newton per meter. Two, an experiment is carried out using a metal wire to investigate how it responds to a varying tensile force. The cross-sectional area of the wire is constant. So the cross-sectional area is constant. Which graph has a gradient that is equal to the Young modulus of a metal? So we know that Young modulus is equal to force per unit area, extension divided by original length, or Young modulus is equal to stress by strain. So we need to find that which graph shows the gradient that is equal to the Young modulus. So for the first and the second option, we know that F is equal to Kx, that is force is equal to constant into extension. So constant is equal to force per unit extension. So force per unit extension is in option B, that is it is the spring constant K, not the Young modulus. So this is the spring constant K, that is the force per unit extension. And for the options C and D, we know that Young modulus is equal to stress by strain. So stress by strain, so stress on the y-axis and strain on the x-axis. So stress divided by strain, that is gradient is equal to y value by x value. So y value, that is the stress, and the x value, that is the strain. So stress by strain is the gradient, that is the gradient. And we know that gradient is equal to Young modulus, that is stress by strain. So yes, the option C is correct. And for the option D, we have given strain against stress. So strain against stress, this graph is basically for 1 by E, not Young modulus. So the correct answer is C. 3. For a wire, Hooke's law is obeyed for tension F and extension X. So we know that for Hooke's law, force is directly proportional to extension, or force is equal to constant into extension. And the Young modulus for the material of the wire is E. So we have given the value of Young modulus. Which expression represents the elastic potential energy stored in the wire? So elastic potential energy, that is elastic potential energy is equal to half Fx, or half Kx square. So half Fx is in option C, so the answer is C. Question number 24. A plane polarized wave has amplitude A. The wave is incident normally on a polarizing filter. So the plane polarized wave, that means the waves that are coming are polarized, has an amplitude A, and the waves are incident on a polarizing filter. The transmission axis of the filter is at an angle of theta, the plane of polarization of the incident waves. So in respective to the initial waves, the axis is at an angle of theta. So in respective to the initial waves, the axis is at an angle of theta. So theta. So theta is always calculated with respective to the initial waves and the transmission axis. So with respective to the initial waves and the transmission axis, theta is calculated. Since the waves that are coming are vertical and the transmission axis is in this direction, so the theta is from the initial waves and in respective to the transmission axis. So what is the amplitude of the wave that emerges from the filter? So what is the amplitude that emerges from the filter? So we refer this as x, and we know that intensity is equal to initial intensity cos square theta, and we also know that intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. So to use this formula, we need to substitute the amplitude values in this equation. So we know that I1 by I2 is equal to A1 square by A2 square. So, or instead, we can just substitute the amplitude values in this equation, and we know that intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. So, in, in terms, instead of intensity, we can substitute the amplitude square. So the initial amplitude is A. So intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. So instead of intensity, we substitute just amplitude square cos square theta. And instead of intensity, we just substitute amplitude square. So amplitude square, since intensity is directly proportional to amplitude square. So x would be A cos theta. So the correct answer would be A. 25. An electromagnetic wave is traveling through a vacuum. What could be the wavelength and period of the electromagnetic wave? So we need to find that what is the period and wavelength of the electromagnetic wave. So we know that V is equal to F lambda, and in vacuum we know that the speed of the electromagnetic wave is 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. So 3 × 10⁸ meter per second, and V is equal to F lambda. So instead of F, we can substitute 1 by time period, that is frequency is equal to 1 by time period. So lambda by time period. So whichever values, that is the lambda by time period, gives the value, that is the speed, that is 3 × 10⁸, would be the correct answer. So the answer would be C, that this value divided by this value is 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. So 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. Therefore, the answer C is correct. And you need to know these prefixes. That is, tera is 10⁻¹2, giga is 10⁻⁹, mega is 10⁻⁶, kilo is 10⁻³, deci is 10⁻⁹, centi is 10⁻⁹2, milli is 10⁻⁹3, micro is 10⁻⁹6, nano is 10⁻⁹9, and pico is 10⁻⁹12. So the correct answer would be C. In question number 26, light of frequency given in a vacuum is incident normally on a diffraction grating that contains 4 × 10⁵ lines per meter. So this is the lines per meter. What is the angle between the adjacent second and third order intensity maxima? So basically, the light is incident on the diffraction grating and it gets diffracted, and we need to find the angle between the adjacent second order and the third order maxima. So basically, if you see this diagram, then this is the zeroth order, this is the first order, this is the second order, and this is the third order. So we need to find the angle between the second and the third order maximum, that is the angle alpha. And to find this value of angle, we need to find the angle between with respect to the zeroth order to the second order, and then from with respect to zero order to the third order. Then alpha is equal to third order, that is the third order, that is this order, minus the second order, to find the value of alpha, that is the angle between the second and third order angle. So we know that d sine theta is equal to n lambda, that is d sine theta is equal to n lambda, and here we have given the value of frequency and lines per meter. So lines per meter, so what is the value of d? We know that d is equal to 1 by n, where n is the number of lines per meter. So the value of d would be 1 by n, that is the number of lines per meter. So this is the value of d. So we know the value of d, and we need to find the value of sine theta, and this is n lambda. So we know the value of n is second, that is 2 and 3. So it is either 2 for the second order and 3 for the third order. And the value of lambda, so we know the value of frequency, and we need to find the value of lambda. So we know that V is equal to F lambda. So lambda would be V by F. Lambda would be V by F. So we know that speed of light is 3 × 10⁸ meter per second in vacuum. And by frequency is equal to the wavelength, that is a lambda. So we know the value of lambda. So we know the value of lambda, that is this lambda, and we know the value of N. Now we need to find sine theta. That is sine theta for the second order. So sine theta for second order, that is when n is equal to 2, sine theta is equal to n lambda, that is when n is equal to 2 by d. So we get the value of theta 1 from this expression, that is the value of theta 1. And for the value of theta 2, that is third order, and this is for second order. So third order, sine theta is equal to n, that is the value of 3, lambda by d. So theta is equal to sine inverse of this value. So we get the value of third order and the second order.
So what is the alpha? Alpha is the third order minus the second order, that is 20.95. So after subtracting the value, we get a value of angle as 12 degree. So the correct answer would be question 27. The siren of a moving police car emits a sound with the frequency given. So this is the frequency that is emitted, or the frequency of the source. The station observer hears the sound of frequency given. The speed of the sound in air is given. So this is the frequency that is observed, that is FO. What could be the speed and the duration of movement of the car? So what is the speed and the duration of movement of the car? Now, here we can see that the observed frequency is greater than the emitting frequency. Since the observed frequency is more, so the car is moving towards the observer. If the observed frequency is more, then the car is moving towards the observer. But if the observed frequency is less compared to the frequency that is emitted, then the source is moving away from the observer. And we know that FO is equal to FSV, V plus minus VS, where FO is the observed frequency. FS is the frequency of the source, VS is the frequency of the source, and V is the speed of the sound in air. So we need to find the speed of the car, or the speed of the source, that is VS. So we need to find the value of VS. And since we can see that the observed frequency is greater than the emitting frequency, so the object is moving towards the observer. So FO is equal to FSV, V minus VS. So we substitute the value of FO and the value of FS and the value of V, that is the speed of the sound. We get the value of VS as 37.1. So the answer is 37.1. And since the observed frequency is more than the emitting frequency, so the object is moving towards the observer. So the answer is B. 28. The diagram shows the shape of at one instant in a time of part of a stretched string as a wave travels along it from left to right. So from left to right. What is the direction of velocities of the point 1, 2, and 3 on the string at this instant of time? So what is the direction of velocity? So the direction of velocity of 1, 2, and 3. So for particle 1, since the wave behind this point is down, so the particle 1 is moving downwards. And for particle 2, since the wave behind this wave is upwards compared to the front, so it is moving upward. Since the wave behind this point is up, so it is moving up. Similarly, for particle 3, since the wave behind this point is down, so the particle 3 is moving down. So particle 3 is moving down, 2 is moving up, and 1 is moving down. So the answer is D. Question 29. Which wave cannot be a longitudinal wave? So polarized wave cannot be a longitudinal wave, because to polarize a wave, it must have to be a transverse wave. It must have to be a transverse wave. It cannot be a longitudinal wave. So the correct answer is B. T. Microwaves are emitted from two sources at point X and Y. The two waves meet at point Z. The diagram shows the path of the two waves. So they are emitted from X and Y, and the two waves meet at point Z. The waves emitted from point X and Y are coherent. Coherent means they have a constant phase difference. The meaning of coherent is that the waves have a constant phase difference. So coherent means the waves have a constant phase difference, and this property, that is the coherent, is needed for interference. That means if the waves are coherent, then the interference occurs. If the waves are not coherent, then no interference occurs. You must need to remember these two points. What is a direct consequence of the two waves being coherent? So there is a constant difference in phase. So there must be a constant phase difference. That is, the two waves must have a constant phase difference since they are coherent between the two waves at Z. So between the two waves at point Z. So the two waves must have a constant phase difference as point Z. So the answer is B. Number 31. What is the unit of resistivity? So resistance is equal to resistivity into length by cross-sectional area, and resistivity is equal to resistance into cross-sectional area by length. So we know the unit of resistance is ohm, area is meter square, and length is meter. So meter and meter cancels, and the unit of resistivity comes to ohm meter. So the answer is D. In question number 32, a kettle is connected to a 250 volt main supply. What are the possible values of power of the kettle and the current in the kettle? So power and the current. So power and current, we know that power is equal to voltage into current. Power is equal to VI, or power is equal to watt done by time taken, or power is equal to I square R, or power is equal to V square by R. So by using the relationship voltage, power and current, we know that power is equal to VI. So V is equal to power by I. So power by current, whichever the value of power by current, so power by current gives the value of 250, that is the value of voltage, is the correct answer. So power by current, so that is 10, gives the value of 250. So the correct answer is D, that is the voltage is 250. Number 33, which circuit results in the output voltage V out increasing with increasing in temperature? So first of all, this symbol that we have given is the symbol of thermistor. So this is the symbol of thermistor, and this symbol refers to a variable resistor, and this symbol refers to light dependent resistor. Now this is the variable resistor, this is the light dependent resistor, and this is a thermistor. So V out increasing with increasing temperature, that means the temperature is increased, and we know that thermistor, increasing temperature decreases the resistance, so the resistance decreases. So increasing temperature decreases the resistance. For thermistor, increasing temperature decreases the resistance, since resistance is inversely proportional to temperature. So increasing temperature, resistance decreases, since resistance decreases, so voltage across the thermistor decreases. So voltage across the thermistor decreases. Now for option 1, here we can see that the V out is the total voltage that is being supplied. So if the voltage that is being supplied is V, then the V out is V. If the voltage is 2V, then the V out is 2V. So whether the temperature is increasing or decreasing, there is no effect on the V out, since V out is equal to the EMF, so there is no change. But we need to find the V out that is increasing. Then for option B, here we can see that it is connected with the thermistor. So as we can see that increasing temperature decreases the resistance, and decreasing the resistance decreases the voltage. So here V out is decreasing, not increasing. Therefore this is wrong. Then for option C, here we can see that increasing temperature, since temperature increases, the resistance across the thermistor decreases. Resistance across the thermistor decreases, so voltage across the thermistor decreases. Since voltage across the thermistor decreases and the total EMF remains the same, so that means total EMF is same, but this voltage decreases, so the voltage across this resistor must increase. Since this voltage decreases, so this voltage must increase, so V out must increase. So the correct answer would be C, that is the V out is increasing. And for option D, here we can see that increasing temperature, for a resistor, increasing temperature, the resistance increases. Since resistance increases, but the resistance for both the resistors is increases, because increasing temperature increases the resistance, and the resistance of both the resistors are increases, that means the V out would remain the same for both the resistor. Therefore, this is not the correct answer, and the correct answer is C. Number 34, four resistors, each of resistance R, are connected as shown. So four resistors are connected. The total resistance between point X and point Y is given. So the total resistance, that is R total, is given. What is the magnitude of resistance R? So all have a resistance R. So we know that for the parallel combinations, since the resistors are connected in parallel, so we know that 1 by R total is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. And if you just consider this as R1 and this 3 as R2, that means the circuit is like this, that this one is R1 and this 3 are R2. So that is, this is R1 and this 3 as R2, then 1 by R1 is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2, that is R plus R plus R, that is 3R, is equal to the R total. So by solving this equation, we get the value of R as 160 ohm. So the answer is C.
Number 35, a cell with internal resistance is connected to a variable resistor R as shown. The resistance of the R is gradually decreased. So the resistance of R is gradually decreased. How do the current and the terminal potential difference across the cell change? So current and the terminal potential difference across the cell. So the resistance of R is gradually decreased, so resistance decreases, and since resistance decreases, we know that as resistance decreases, current increases. And since current increases, the lost volt, that is, the potential difference across the internal resistance, is equal to I smaller. So as current increases, due to decrease in resistance, current increases, and so current increases, therefore the lost volt also increases. Therefore the lost volt increases. And we know that EMF is equal to terminal potential difference across the cell plus potential difference across the internal resistance. So terminal potential difference is equal to EMF minus potential difference across the internal resistance. So terminal potential difference is equal to EMF minus potential difference across the internal resistance. And as resistance of the resistor decreases, resistance decreases, so current increases. And as current increases, the lost volt increases. Since the lost volt increases, so the terminal potential difference decreases. Since the lost volt increases, so the terminal potential difference decreases. So it should decrease, and the current increases. So current increases due to decrease in resistance. 6. The diagram shows a circuit with a cell and three resistors R1, R2, and R3. The cell has negligible internal resistance. So negligible internal resistance, the total resistance of the circuit is R total. Which equation for R total is correct? So we know that R total is equal to, that is, since the resistors are arranged in parallel, so 1 by R total, that is R total, is equal to 1 by R1 plus R2, since they are arranged in series, so 1 by R1 plus R2 plus 1 by R3. So 1 by R total is equal to 1 by R1 plus R2 plus 1 by R3. Question number 37. Hydrogen and deuterium can be represented by the nuclear symbols hydrogen and deuterium. What is the difference between hydrogen and deuterium? So the deuterium atom has twice the number of electrons as the hydrogen atom. So for hydrogen, the number of electrons is 1, while for deuterium, the number of electrons is 1. That is the same as the number of protons. Therefore, they have the same, not twice. Then the deuterium nucleus has a charge, but the hydrogen nucleus has no charge. So we know that charge is equal to number of protons or the number of electrons. So for charge, if we consider the number of protons, then hydrogen has 1 proton, while deuterium has 1 proton. So both have a charge of 1. So deuterium has a charge, but hydrogen also have a charge, that is, both have a charge of 1. Therefore, it is wrong. Then the deuterium nucleus has less mass than the hydrogen nucleus. So the mass number of deuterium is 2. So mass number is equal to number of protons plus number of neutrons. So mass number is equal to number of protons plus number of neutrons. So here the mass number is 2, here the mass number is 1. So the deuterium has twice the mass compared to hydrogen. So this is wrong, this is not less. Then the deuterium nucleus has half the charge per unit mass of the hydrogen nucleus. So charge per unit mass for deuterium, the charge is 1. So if you consider the number of protons or the number of electrons, so for deuterium, the number of protons is 1, so the charge is 1, and the mass is 2. So 1 by 2 for deuterium, and for hydrogen, the mass is 1, that is 1, and the charge is also 1. So here we can see that deuterium nucleus has half the charge per unit mass of the hydrogen nucleus. So the answer is D is correct. Question number 38. A radioactive sample decays by emitting beta minus particle. The energy released in the decay process is same for each nucleus that decays, but beta minus particles are emitted have a continuous range of kinetic energy. Which statement explains why beta minus particles are emitted with a continuous range of kinetic energy? So when beta minus particles are emitted, they have a continuous range of kinetic energy, but when alpha particles are emitted, they have discrete amount of kinetic energy. And discrete amount of kinetic energy, so alpha particles are emitted, they have discrete amount of kinetic energy, that means the kinetic energy of alpha particle is same. But for beta particle, here it has a continuous range of kinetic energy, that means the kinetic energy of beta minus particle varies. So the kinetic energy of beta minus particle varies because when beta minus decay occurs, antineutrino is produced and some of the energy is released is taken by this antineutrino. So the answer is B. Also, you need to remember the two equations, that is, when beta plus decay occur, so beta plus decay, proton changes to a neutron, positron, so this is positron and this is neutrino, and energy is released. And when beta minus particles are emitted,
neutron changes to a proton, electron, so electron and antineutrino, and energy is released. So when beta plus particles are emitted, this equation, and from beta minus particle decays, this equation. You need to remember this. 39. Which particle is not a fundamental particle? So electron is fundamental, neutrino is fundamental, and top quark is fundamental. But neutron is made up of up, down, down quark, and proton is made up of up, up, down quark. So here neutron is not fundamental, therefore the answer is C. And for option 4, question number 40, what is the charge of an anti-top quark? So up, top, and charm quark have a charge of plus 2 by 3e, while down, strange, and bottom quark have a charge of negative 1 by 3e. And since it is anti-top, so top has a charge of plus 2 by 3, plus 2 by 3e. But since it is anti-top, so the sign would be reversed. Then that means it is now negative 2 by 3e. So the answer is A.